227, and I just remind y'all, if you would, we could go ahead and do that now. If I know some people, their work and stuff, they've got to have cell phone with them. If you would, just put your cell phones on vibrate at least, if you've got to have it and have it on. I know some people use that for Bible as well, so that way we don't want to give Satan any extra ways to try to distract us this morning, because we want the Lord to speak to each one of our hearts. And so this is a great song here. Y'all know I love this song, Saved by the Blood. Let's stand. We'll do all four verses. Y'all sing out this morning, all right? Michael, would you lead us this morning?
And Father, we are glad that we are saved.
Amen.
By the blood of Yes. And today, may your word again go forth with power and with might, and that Lord, we might again see souls change for the glory of
yes.
you. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Again, we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
And welcome once again to Calvary Baptist Church. I'm glad to be back with the people of God. I so look forward to this time on Sundays with you folks, and hope you've had a great week. I've got a few announcements I want to emphasize to you this morning, but the first and most important one is about Ashley Byram. She enrolled yesterday in a weight loss program that was very successful, and overnight she lost about 7 pounds and 5 ounces. So if you're interested in how she did it, it won't do you much good to come to me unless you want to get, if we've got childbearing ladies here that would like to get pregnant once again, that's how that works. But we rejoice in the fact that Levi Byram came into the world at 9:23 last night. Again, 7 pounds, 5 ounces, and he is 20.5 inches long. So continue to pray for Mom and for Levi, for their health and so forth. Ashley, I expect, has a little recovering to do after the delivery process. But we're just rejoicing in the Lord. We have a new member here at Calvary Baptist Church, man. We're growing. We're growing, man. I like to grow that way, too. And also, today is Super Sunday. You see that in the bulletin? Immediately following the service, you're invited to come to the fellowship hall and pick up some packaged soup to take home to heat up and eat whenever you'd like. Some ladies made this yesterday, and it looks like homemade chicken vegetable soup. So you don't want to leave that behind, do you? So don't forget. You're not going to forget, are you?
Nope.
You're Baptist. You won't forget about food, right? So after the service, going over to the fellowship hall. And then in our annual business meeting that we had this past Tuesday night, we recommended two new deacons to the congregation, and we wanted you to have time to pray about that. Ashley Byram, talking about her earlier, but we recommended her husband to the congregation, Daniel Byram, and also Brother Barry Hill to become two new deacons to help us out around here. At the end of the service next Sunday morning, we'll hand out some 3x5 cards to you, and you can write down your vote on those cards. But we want you to be praying about God's leading and direction in this matter this upcoming week, if you would do so. And then your 2022 contribution envelopes are right down here, right to the left of where Daniel is sitting right now. It's a record of what you gave this past year, so don't forget to come and get those. And then one of the more important announcements I have for you this morning, you'll notice all the patriotic decorations, right? And that means we've got a God and Country rally here Thursday night. It's kind of a statewide rally. They have a few of them around the state, but we'll have pastors coming in from different parts of the state. Some of our state legislators will be here. Brother Byron Fox, the evangelist, will be here. Chad Conley with Faith Wins, and some other godly dignitaries will be here too. And we've got a lot of folks from the local churches that'll be coming. So I encourage you to come early. There'll be a pastor's prayer meeting at 6:15, and anybody that wants to take part in the choir that night, they'll be meeting in here at 6:15 for the choir practice. Prayer meeting in the fellowship hall, choir practice in here. But that is right Thursday night at 7 o'clock. So everybody come. This is going to be a big deal. It was a big deal last year from what they told me. I was so enthusiastic about it last year, I didn't even show up. I don't know if I should advertise that, but I had my one and only experience with Mr. COVID. So I wasn't able to be here last January, so I am really looking forward to being here for this one. If I don't show up for this one, I think Byron's just going to write me off forever. So pray that I'll be healthy Thursday night so that I can be here for the God and Country Rally. All right, I think that'll do it. For there are other announcements, please read. But at this time, brethren, if you would go ahead and come, and we will receive an offering for the Lord this morning. And Brother Randy, would you pray for us as we prepare to give?
Faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray, take all my guilt away. From this day be holy thine. While life's dark maze I tread, and griefs around me spread, be thou my guide. Bid darkness turn to day, wipe sorrow's tears away. Oh, let me from this day from thee abide. When ends life's transient dream, when death's cold threatening stream shall o'er me roll, blessed Savior, then in love, fear and distrust remove. Oh, lift me safe above a ransomed soul. A ransomed soul.
time to turn to hymn number 206. I was reading over this song, and it's got some great words. I hope you'll pay attention to the words you're singing. And let's stand. We'll do all four verses. Oh, say, but I'm glad.
Of sin from my life. Oh,
Well, while the choir's finding their way to their seats, you can go ahead and turn to John chapter 4 this morning. John chapter 4. As you know, the last few Sunday mornings I've been doing sermons on the life of Christ. And everything is as I anticipated. I knew that if I spent more time studying the life of Christ, it would be a great blessing to my soul, and I have not been disappointed. I feel like I know him at least a little bit better than I had before, and that is the key to so many great blessings in the Christian life. I want to speak to you this morning about a very common story, concerning a very common story you've heard before, the woman at the well. But maybe I'll be able to bring out some things that maybe you've never heard in exactly the same way before, hopefully, and I have prayed this way that it would make an impression upon your heart. I want you to leave here today with a better understanding and appreciation for just how wonderful your Savior is, how loving He is, how compassionate He is, and how burdened He is that the lost come to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, we're in John chapter 4. I'll be looking at various verses in just a moment, but let me just say a word about this woman at the well. She was likely the loneliest woman in the world. The trouble was, she was far too good-looking for her own good, far too popular with men. And one can well imagine the gossip that surrounded her name. For human nature hasn't changed a bit, not even in 2,000 years. And so this woman was the butt of the village gossips. And certainly it seems that to some extent she deserved the likely remarks made behind her back and even to her face. We don't know her name. We don't know her age. We simply know her as the woman at the well, for it is as such that we are introduced to her by the Apostle John. Well, on her way to the well that day, the woman passed 12 men, all Jews, disciples of Christ. As you read through the chapter, you come across that verse where it talks about that these disciples were making their way into town. She was making her way out of town to the edge of town to where the well was. And no doubt they passed by on either side of the street. And she, we can be sure, probably gave them the haughtiest look, and they kept the width of the road between her and them, because she was a woman of Samaria. And between Jews and Samaritans, a little love was lost. The racial prejudice was very old, and its roots ran very deep. You know, when the Assyrians invaded Israel hundreds of years before, they destroyed Samaria and they carried away into captivity 10 of the tribes of Israel, and they left behind them a spoil and plundered land. The other thing that you need to know about the Assyrians, however, is that into that land, they sent immigrants from other parts of their empire. And before long, these pagans picked up kind of a pseudo-Judaism, a jumble of truth and error, a weird mixture of faith and falsehood. And as time went on, they considered themselves every bit as good as the Jews still living in Judea to the south. Well, after Nebuchadnezzar came along, he carried the Jews of Judah into captivity as well. And when that happened, the Samaritans that were left there considered themselves to be even better than the Jews. So you've got this mindset going on. Now, when the Jews came back from captivity, what's kind of interesting is that the Samaritans were quite prepared to offer to them the right hand of fellowship and to treat them as equals, kind of as co-religionists, as heirs together of the same vital truths, but the indignant Jews would have no part of it. And bitter hostility was born. I'm talking about hostility that lasted for centuries leading up to the time of Christ. So the Lord's disciples certainly had no intention of lowering themselves by talking to a Samaritan woman. And the Samaritan woman had no intention either of passing the time of day with a dozen Jews trespassing in Samaria. So they passed each other by. The Lord's disciples went on their way, wrapped in religious prejudice, congratulating each other that they had not demeaned themselves in talking to the Samaritan woman. They had shown her, and maybe they had, but one thing they had not shown her was Christ. So that lonely woman went on her way to the well. And as she drew near, she saw something that must have annoyed her immediately. There was someone already there. You know, probably the sole reason why this woman went to the well at the hour of high noon, when the sun was at its hottest, when sensible people found a shady spot for their midday meal and siesta, the reason why she went at this time was to avoid people, just to get away from people. And so she goes to the well, and now there's already someone there. Worse still, it was a man, and even worse than that, worst of all, it was another Jew. So this is the context. This is what's playing out. No doubt Jesus ignored any contemptuous look that she might have imparted to him as she came walking up to the well right where he was sitting. And I'm sure she was thinking, you know, why in the world couldn't he sit somewhere else? Why? Well, I want to tell you, it's because he had come that way just to meet her. And her whole life was about to change. Jesus asked her for a drink, and she must have almost dropped her bucket right down into the well. She was shocked. He, being a Jew, asked her, a woman of Samaria, for a drink of water. And when the Lord did that, he deliberately opened himself up to insult or perhaps misunderstanding, scorn, or refusal. But he did it because he wanted to win this lonely woman to himself. So he said, "Give me to drink." And she said, "How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria?" And with that follows one of the most wonderful conversations that take up such a large part of the Gospel of John. You know, the first thing that the Lord's going to deal with her about three different things. And the first thing that he starts to deal with her on in their conversation is the harsh realities of life. So Jesus begins to deal with her first off along the lines of the physical. that woman, for that woman to get sufficient water to drink and to use around the house was very hard work. The water was heavy. The way was long. The sun was hot, as you can imagine. And she would have to let a bucket down about 100 feet to draw up water. And then she would pour it into the pot. And then she would have to lower the bucket once again, bring it back up again until that water pot was full. And then she would have to get that water pot on her shoulder or on her head, and she would have to carry it all the way back home. I tell you what, for this lady, life was hard. Life was hard. So the Lord talked to her at the most convenient point of contact. He talked to her about water. He talked to her about thirst. He talked to her about need. He talked to her about desire. But it was not only water that made her life hard. She had other thirsts, other longings, other cravings besides water. Her life was filled, in fact, with unsatisfied longings. As a fresh young girl, she had doubtless dreamed romantic dreams. She had always been able to get all the men she wanted, but somehow it never satisfied. She had thought that she would be happy when she got married, but that didn't last, and the honeymoon was soon over. Then she thought she would be happy when she got a divorce from her first husband, but divorce didn't make her happy either. Then she thought, well, you know what, I just need to find the right man. So I'll get married again and find happiness. But that didn't happen. And so husband number two came along, and that didn't work out. And fact of the matter is, nothing that she had tried or was trying was satisfying the deep thirst of her soul. She tried, as one writer put, she tried the broken cisterns of life, but she was still thirsty. Maybe someone like that here this morning. You know, Solomon had the same trouble. He had tried many different things too in order to find contentment, satisfaction, and peace and fulfillment. He tried collecting doctor's degrees, becoming the world's greatest intellectual, having his name and fame carried far and wide, being visited by celebrities. But it was all so much emptiness. He tried women, 1,000 of them. I kind of have to laugh at this particular point because no doubt Solomon spent a great portion of his life going to his own weddings. Right? 1,000. But that didn't satisfy. It took him 1,000 tries before he discovered that there was not a woman in the world who could really meet the deepest hunger of his heart. I love my wife. I love her more today than I did the day I married her. And next to my relationship with Christ, she is the greatest thing in my life. But let me tell you what, folks, without Christ in my life, she would never be able to satisfy the deep thirst of my soul. As good as she is. Solomon tried wealth. He made money. He made lots of money. He was the smartest, the most successful Jewish businessman in all the world in his day. But you know what? He grew tired of it all. He thought he might just as well commit suicide, but in the end, he wrote the book of Ecclesiastes instead, a sad dirge over the utter inability of anything under the sun to satisfy the deep spiritual hunger of a human heart. And I'm sure there's someone like that here today. You've been looking for contentment and satisfaction in all the wrong places for years now. When are you going to turn to Christ and find what quenches the thirst of your heart and soul? Like Solomon, the poor woman at the well was still thirsty. You know, we're all born thirsty. And as time goes on and we grow older, and our thirst increase, we take on new thirsts. We actually go out of our way at times to create thirst that God never intended for us to have. A thirst for drink, a thirst for drugs, a thirst for tobacco, a thirst for marijuana, a thirst for angel dust, a thirst for cocaine, a thirst for heroin. None of it satisfied. A thirst for money. But again, that doesn't satisfy either. And we do that until at last life for some becomes one vast craving for something that will satisfy. You know, thankfully, praise the Lord that as some people get older, after they have tried many different things in the world and have found out that nothing truly satisfies them, then they get serious about seeking God and the truth of the gospel. And they turn to Christ. Maybe you're like that here this morning. You know what? It would be better if you turned to Christ early in life rather than later. But whatever you do, turn to Christ before it's too late. Because he's the only one that can satisfy and give you the abundant life. I found something interesting. I was reading a book by John Phillips, and kind of partial to this man for obvious reasons. Share the last name. I don't think we share the same intelligence level, however. I've got all of John Phillips's commentaries and character studies and of the Bible and all of his books. Anyway, in one of the books he wrote this. Y'all still with me too? Yeah. You know, I'm tremendously insecure. I have to check in once in a while. He wrote this. He said, let me get a drink of water first. He said, several years ago, at a church service in North Carolina, I met a nurse who shared her story with me. She said, when I was a teenager, I thought I knew it all and nobody else knew anything. I had all the answers. But then I became a drug addict, and I continued being a drug addict until the Lord saved me after 11 long, miserable years. When I first started going with the crowd, I thought I was doing something smart. But when I got hooked, I found I was not so smart after all. Thousands of milligrams of tranquilizers, barbiturates, and other pills became her regular diet. She wanted to quit, but she couldn't. The habit took all the money she could make. It took food off of her table. It took clothes off of her back. She wanted to quit. She tried the usual methods of withdrawal, and a doctor was able to get her off the habit by gradually reducing the dosage in a hospital. She was sent home cured, but 24 hours later she started having withdrawal pains, and she said, I would break out in a cold sweat, I would be sick, my facial muscles would draw, my tongue become thick. When I tried to talk, my mouth would distort round to the side of my face, the muscles on my legs and arms would draw. I would have severe stomach and abdominal pains. I would have hallucinations and horrible nightmares. I would have sold my soul for a fix. I lied, I stole, I cheated, I sold drugs to get money to get drugs. And so it went on for 11 years. 11 years of living hell, she said. Time and time again, she tried to quit, but each time, as soon as the withdrawal symptoms started, back she went again. Then she began to lose her eyesight. She lost weight. Her hair began to fall out. Her teeth became loose. She became so desperate, she took a can opener and slashed her flesh and licked the blood. Then one day she was saved. She said, I fell on my face before God. I cried, God, have mercy on me. I am sorry for my life. I am sick of my life. I cannot go on this way. Please save me. And all that heavy burden lifted, I did not know it at the moment, but I had been born again as the days went by. I began to realize I had not the first desire for drugs, and I had not had a single withdrawal symptom. It was 5 months before she could go back to work. She felt a sense of mental depression, but after a while, even that cleared up. And she says, for years now, I have been on the nursing staff of a hospital. I put my hands all the time on the narcotics and drugs I used to use, drugs I used to steal. It is just as if I never had the habit. I am a new creature in Christ. That's what Jesus offers the woman at the well. That's what Jesus offers to each of you this morning. If you've never taken of that living water, you can have it today. Don't ignore me. There's some of you here, if I can be so candid and blunt, that I don't know if you are saved or not. I prayed for you this morning. I prayed specifically for some folks here this morning. I do not assume that everybody here is saved. I have my doubts. Again, I'm not trying to be rude, but I want to confront you with the gospel today and ask you today, unlike the many times that you've put off the Lord Jesus Christ at the well, I'm asking that today you listen to what God has to say and the Word of God has to say to you and respond and receive Christ as Savior. If you do not, and I will not back off here, you will die and spend an eternity in a burning hell. And I know that's not politically correct to preach that anymore, but I'm not interested in being politically correct. I want to give the truth. As the woman at the well grew older, she thought she could fill the emptiness in her heart with men. When all the time she was really thirsty for God and didn't know it. So Jesus offered her living water as seen in John 4:10. If thou knewest the gift of God, he said, which by the way is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. If thou knewest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me drink. Thou wouldest have asked of him and he would have given the living water. And after a moment's hesitation, this lady said in so many words, where is this water coming from you're talking about? She still thought he was talking about literal water from Jacob's well. So he said in verses 13 and 14, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. She said, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw, in verse 15. You know what? She was tired of her life, as it was. And she may have been still unsure what he was offering her exactly, but she had this sense that what he was offering was something that she wanted and something that she needed. Have you come to that realization yourself in your life? Do you understand just how badly, how desperately you all need Jesus Christ? Life will never be any good until he is your Savior and Master. Well, The Lord Jesus had dealt with the harsh realities of her life. Now he would deal with the hidden realities of her life. She said, "Give me this water." He said in verse 16, "Go call thy husband and come hither." What? He deliberately touched a raw nerve, and he knew it. But she could never have life everlasting until she faced the realities in her life, the deep hidden things, the things she thought he knew nothing about, her sin. Jesus didn't condemn her. But neither did he cover up the festering moral sore in her life. I mean, Jesus is getting close to home now. He is moving in. And she's becoming uncomfortable to a certain extent. Jesus again said, "Go call thy husband and come hither." She brushed off the suggestion immediately with a half-truth. She said, "I have no husband." And then Jesus showed her quite plainly that he knew all about the things that she would try to hide. I don't know if you're trying to hide anything this morning, but as the writer of Hebrews said, everything is naked and open before the eyes of him with whom we have to do. And God knows everything that you do, and he knows every thought that you think. He knows everything that's going on the inside as well as the outside. Well, he knew the whole sad story of husband after husband until finally she decided just to move in with the next man without even bothering about the formality of marriage. In verse 18, he said, "Thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that saidst thou truly." You know, the woman's problem was much deeper than unsatisfied longings. Her real problem was her disregard of God's moral law. And standing there before the kind but searching eyes of the Son of God, this woman felt suddenly ashamed. Ashamed of her immoralities, of her libertarian views. She was ashamed of her sin. You know, Jesus never once mentioned the word sin, but he didn't need to. She knew her life was stained with sin, no matter how hard she might try to block it out. So anyway, by way of review, Jesus deals with a woman concerning her physical and then her moral issues. Now he deals, lastly, with her along the line of that which is spiritual and her spiritual needs. It's kind of interesting at this point in the passage, the woman hastily changes the subject. And in verse 20, she raises a question about comparative religion. She said, "Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship." I challenge you to study John chapter 4 and see if Jesus said anything about that. He didn't. He made no mention of that. It was just a ploy by this woman to get her off the subject of her sin. You know, like many people, she was quite willing to talk to Jesus about religion, but she didn't want to talk about sin. You know? A lot of folks that way. But the religion she professed to embrace had never satisfied her longings, had never dealt with the sin question in her life, and had never brought her anywhere near the everlasting life that Jesus was offering to her. Jesus politely answered her comment, then he confronted her with the true nature of God in verse 21. Basically, he said, you know, what I'm talking about, it's not a question of shrines and sacred places at all. Verse 24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Have you ever worshiped God? Oh, that sounds insulting, doesn't it? Unless you've done it in spirit and in truth, you never have. You may have gone to church, but you didn't worship God. Again, he confronted her with what she was, a sinner, and now a hypocritical sinner, trying to evade the issue by raising an argument about religion instead of dealing with the core problem that she had. Then Jesus introduced a startling revelation. In verse 23, he says, the Father seeketh such to worship him. He seeks those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. He seeks those to worship him who are truthful and repentant about their sin and desire to worship God from the heart. Worship that merely goes through the motions is never good enough with God. What Jesus is saying is that his Father could be her Father. Boom! Things are building to a climax fast. Indeed, his Father, Jesus' Father, was actively seeking people who were willing to be honest, willing to be born again, born of the Spirit, in order that they might worship God Almighty. And that's exactly why Jesus came to the well that day. The woman again had changed the subject, but this time she was not trying to be evasive, just wanting to be sure. Now we are coming to the climax. What a climax it is. In verse 25, she says, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things. Verse 26, Jesus, I that speak unto thee am he. I would love to have seen the look on her face at that moment. I want to talk to the woman at the well when I get home to heaven. I want to know what she felt at that moment. She now realizes that she is face to face with God. Now she knew it all. She knew her sin. She knew her Savior. She knew that she had to come, that she had come to the crossroads of life, and more importantly, she knew that the decision of what to do with Christ would determine her fate not only for the rest of her life, but for all eternity. She knew it. Do you? Hey, what will you do with Christ? What will you do with Christ? If you don't receive him, then your eternity in hell. You'll remember this day when I ask you that question, and it will haunt you forever. What will you do with Christ? This is the moment of decision. You may not have tomorrow. What you do, you must do now, because now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation, Scripture says. Praise God, she made the right decision and accepted Christ as her Savior. And then the woman quietly left, but she left a changed woman. Second major point of this sermon, and it's very brief, is the woman and her witness after being saved. By the way, have you become a witness since you've been saved? I mean, this lady, she had struggled all of her life, and now She has received the best news, heard the best news she's ever heard in her life. And the first thing she wants to do is to go and share it with other people. I imagine she's like, man, you can't believe what I just heard. You need to meet this man that I just met. Anyway, she had a silent witness about her. And you know, her witness is twofold. But first of all, her silent witness. We read in verse 28 that the woman left her water pot and went her way into the city. You know, there are probably two reasons why she left that water pot. She left it for Jesus to use. It was her way of saying, Lord, you've given me the greatest experience of my life, and now let me leave you what little I have at your feet for you to see or to use. You've ministered to me. Now let me minister to you. There's not much I can do for you, dear Lord, but I can at least let you have my water pot. Like the widow's mite, she gave what she had to Christ in response to his saving grace. Are you doing that, by the way, as well? There was another reason why she left that water pot. She now had the wondrous water welling up in her soul. She was satisfied at last in that old physical nature with its desires and demands, with its cravings and longings, was forgotten in the surging rush of new life that was now hers. And then we read about her spoken witness in verses 28 and 29. It says that the woman went her way into the city and saith to the men, you know, to the men that she had probably lived with, to her five former husbands, the man that she had moved in with, she said this, she said, come, see a man which told me all things that I ever did. Is not this the Christ? And then she brought them into Jesus, and they too believed on him. That was her spoken witness. What had happened to her was too good to keep to herself. Do y'all feel that way about the gospel? She simply had to share it with others. And who to share her new birth with than those that she had shared her past life with? I'm done, but let me just say this. Some of you are here this morning merely going through the motions of religion. And deep down in your heart, even you know that will never cut it with God. Please don't talk right now. Please listen to what I say in these closing moments. Deep down in your soul, even you know that the motions of religion won't get you any closer to heaven. And if that weren't bad enough, you have a thirst for something that's never been quenched. My friend, it is your soul crying out for a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. And once you have that, your soul will never thirst again. And then what about we, his saints? Most of us are all too aware of the painful fact that we should be doing a better job getting out the gospel like this woman at the well did after salvation. I sense that there needs to be widespread repentance among the saints this morning. Jesus is at the well of your heart, and he's waiting for your response. What's it going to be? Thank you. Let's pray. Lord, if there's someone here that's not saved this morning, I pray that you would break through all resistance, particularly break through the pride in the life, and may they come to a place of honesty before thee. And Lord, help them to see their sin clearly. Help them to see their unconverted condition plainly.
And I pray that there would be an unquenchable thirst in their heart today that would drive them to the foot of the cross where they might receive Christ as their Savior. And Lord, today, if we've not been the witness that we ought to be as saints, I pray that you would convict us sorely and increase our burden for the lost. Lord, may the day never come when we are in heaven and hear the news that someone went to hell because we avoided giving them the gospel. Lord, help us to be fervent and to be faithful in the carrying out of the Great Commission, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please turn in your hymn books to hymn number 280, Softly and Tenderly. Jesus is calling some to salvation, calling some sins or saints to repentance. If God's speaking to you today, again, would you respond and do what he wants you to do with your life? Let's stand and sing. Some of you are new to us here this morning, and I haven't had the privilege to get to know you very well, but those of you that I've been with for some time now, you mean so very much to me. And my question to you is, and I speak to you from the heart, will I see you in heaven one day? Because if I don't, God's going to have to wipe my memory clear of any remembrance of you. Otherwise, it's going to break my heart. I don't see how heaven can be a pleasurable experience when you know that someone you love and care for is now in hell. So I ask you again, will I see all of you in heaven? How do you answer that? If you need to be saved, it's a small thing. I did it as a 13-year-old boy. It didn't take that much courage. I was thirsty at 13. I left the aisle, the pew that I was sitting in, and I came up the aisle back in that fellowship hall, and I took Christ as my Savior. Why don't you do that today? Can you do that much for Christ? Just come. You've been thinking about it for a long time. He's been convicting you for a long time. In the quietness of your bedroom at night, you have these nagging doubts that if you were to die, you don't even know where you would spend eternity. Well, you can answer that question right now if you just come to me and we'll help you. We extend the invitation on verse 2. If God is convicting you and speaking to you, would you come right now? I want to see you in heaven one day. Lift it up on the second.
Come home.
Brother Jerome, would you close in prayer tonight and hope that you can come back tonight at 6 o'clock. Brother Jerome.